speaker for today is Gabriel Trujillo. I believe I pronounced that properly.
Yes, sir.
Gabriel, just for the sake of those who were not here last night, I'd like to, first of all, welcome both of you, and Heidi. Mm-hmm. And would you do us a favor and introduce yourself, tell us where you were born and raised, and your favorite fruit this time. Okay? And also, then Heidi, you can do likewise.
All right. Happy Sabbath. Good morning. My name is Gabriel Trujillo. I was born in Bayamón, Puerto Rico. I am Hispanic, bilingual. My father is Colombian. But yeah, I was born in Puerto Rico. My mom's Puerto Rican. And we moved to Miami, Florida when I was about 1 year old. And then lived there for a few years, about 7 years. And then my father wanted us to be raised in a different environment than the hustle and bustle of the city. And so we had some family in Collisdale, Tennessee. If any of you have gotten a chance to go there in the Collisdale, Udawah area where the Southern Adventist is. But they liked it a lot better. My father felt called that that's where he was supposed to raise his family. And so I've been living there ever since, about 16, 17 years. And my favorite fruit, well, let me tell you a little bit more. I guess I went to Southern Adventist University, graduated with theology about 3 years ago, and now finishing a master's in counseling. And I can tell you more about that when we have our Sabbath school talk. My favorite fruit is banana. It's kind of boring, I know. I mean, I love a bunch of other fruits, believe me. I've been to the Philippines, and they have excellent mangoes. You haven't had a mango, so you have one in the Philippines. But that's true. I'm in Jamaica. Okay, I guess other people would disagree, because we have such a diversity here. It's true. I could get in trouble for what I say. But banana, it's boring. It's original. But I really like to finish my meal with a banana. I love it. Yeah. So, yeah.
Hi. I just want to say I'm so excited to be here and worshiping with you guys. So just thank you for having us. And my name is Heidi. I was born in Washington State, but I actually lived in Africa for the first year of my life. My parents lived in Harare, Zimbabwe for 6 years. So I lived there for their last year. And then we moved to Colorado and then to Michigan and finally settled in Maryland. And now I've been in Tennessee for the last 5 years. Just finished my bachelor's in nursing, so I've just been working as a nurse. And my favorite fruit is a tie between mangoes and strawberries.
Thank you.
Bananas,
boo! Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. I just want to say something here before our speaker speaks. He wants to share something deep from the heart.
Now? I guess I was going to do this when my talk began.
Oh, you save it then.
Okay.
All right, but you're going to be on.
Okay. All right, is this my headset on now? Yes, thank you. I'm going to move, if it's okay with you guys, this pulpit a little closer to you. And as my wife has said, I definitely resonate with that. It is really a delight to be sharing with you guys this morning. It's an honor to be invited to be here and have the chance to share from the Word of God with a different church family. And it's always just so encouraging to see God's people everywhere. Those of you that have gotten the chance to travel outside, you see that we have so much in common when we love the Lord, and it's so enriching to immerse in different cultures. You already have heard some about me, but before I go further with the talk, and as we're going to be sharing a lot of time together, and in two more talks after this, I think it's important to have some honesty between us. And it's time for me to have a confession. The Bible says, confess your sins one to another. And the Bible talks about the support of us having to be, support and encouragement to one another. So I have to start things off being very honest with you. I caused the fire alarm.
Oh.
The pastor had to rub it in that he had his eye inflated and he wasn't there. My friends, and my wife can tell you this. I spent actually 10 months in Norway as a student missionary, and I would wear flip-flops even in the snow. I can handle the cold no problem, even though I'm from Puerto Rico. It's really strange the way God made me, but I wear flip-flops even in the winter. She could tell you all year round, you know, I don't get cold. For whatever reason, even now I'm a little chilly. Maybe it's nerves, maybe it's whatever, but last night I wake up. Thank you, though. I wake up. It's 4:15 in the morning. I didn't realize it was that early. I wake up just freezing cold, my friends, freezing cold. And half asleep, I wander off to the heater, and I turn it on. And you guys know the rest of the story. My wife is saying, "What is going on?" You know, she's confused. I'm confused. My first instinct is to grab my sermon notes. I went up to the trying to ventilate it so the alarm can stop. And so listen, if I see you falling asleep during my talk, I'm going to be honest with you, folks. I'm not going to call you out. You do your thing. I feel bad as it is. I apologize from the bottom of my heart. It's not enough that it was just in the room, but I heard the echoes and people starting to wake up. From my understanding, it resounded everywhere in the camp, and I didn't know that. I'm telling you, I just turned it on. I was trying to keep it warm, and big problem. So I am sorry. Now that that's behind us. Oh, friends, I love to share from the Word of God, and I love to learn from it, for God to speak to us in this way. So let's ask His presence to be with us once again this morning. Oh, Father in heaven, we're already off to a great start, Lord. We are just thankful to be out here in Your nature and fellowshipping with one another. What a privilege and joy. What a gift to be able to commune together, God's people celebrating that we're redeemed by You, by the blood of the Lamb, that we have victory in Christ Jesus, Lord. And so we don't want to leave this retreat the same, God. We want to hear a fresh new word from You, from Your word, and not from the speaker. So I pray, Lord, that You hide the speaker, that You anoint my lips, that You, through Your powerful word, may just communicate to Your people, Lord. That is my sincere prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, the series is called Wise and Otherwise, Lessons from the Story of Solomon. We're going to be looking at three different parts of Solomon's life and see what we can glean, what God has to communicate with us in regards to Solomon's life. But first, you know, I have to tell you why I even picked Solomon in the beginning. You know, I'm so glad that the Bible is the way it is, not sugar-coated, aren't you? Amen. You know, what's interesting is that I had no idea about you guys, Nashville First Seventh-day Adventist Church. I hadn't heard of you before, and coming here as I got a chance to speak with some of you last night and speak with a Pastor Santos and meeting his wife, and as they were telling me, there's about how many, 45, 46 different nationalities, cultures here in this church? Is that true? Such a different diversity. Haitians, all kinds of Caribbeans, Jamaicans, African Americans. I mean, you got them from all over in different Asian cultures. What a treat to be able to have a church family where there's so many different ethnicities, cultures. That, it just sounds phenomenal. You know, that sounds great and dynamic. And what's fantastic is that the Bible, sometimes we forget that the Bible is the same way. Sometimes we think that there's nothing but Daniels in the Bible, or Enochs and Elijahs. Those guys hardly burped, you know, or made any kind of little mistake. But praise the Lord, at least on my end, that I see that there's people that make mistakes in the Bible, quite a few of them, and that God still uses them because it gives me some encouragement. How about you? Amen. You know? The Bible's full of all kinds of different people with different personalities, from the bold Peter to the really shy Andrew, from the powerful preacher Elijah to, you know, the humble servants that we see in the Bible that hardly get mentioned at all. So with all of that, I, being somebody that enjoys human behavior, if from a young age, it's so fascinating to wonder why people do what they do. That's why I'm in the field that I am in mental health counseling, to try to find out why do people do what they do. And, you know, if you're like me, you enjoy watching the Olympics sometimes and seeing those people train. They've trained for such a long time, and now they've come to this point in their life that they're about to perform. If it's either the gymnastics or it's head-to-head competition in the tennis, or pick the sport that you like, the swimming. They've worked so hard, and you're seeing them, how they go about getting just a slight amount of edge on their opponent and studying from that. You know, if you want to become a great swimmer, a great athlete, you got to learn from the best and be watching. And so you can understand my intrigue with Solomon. Solomon, as the Bible talks about Solomon being the greatest king in all of the Bible. The greatest king in all of the Bible. Jesus, even himself in Matthew chapter 6, talks about Solomon saying, even Solomon in all of his splendor was not arrayed like one of these, speaking of the flowers. The Son of God himself was referring back to the glory that was Solomon. I mean, if anybody was anybody, it was Solomon. His fame went through all the Bible. Such a powerful man. This guy was the wisest, the smartest, the most extravagant in his kingdom. What can we learn? How did this begin? How does one man be able to have so much fame, his empire, his work? How did that happen? That intrigues me. I've always been intrigued by the character, by the persona, the personality of this Solomon. We're going to study together. What was his beginnings? You know, in the few experiences that I've had with counseling as I'm in my internship right now, when someone comes into counseling, of course, they come in with a presenting problem is what we call it when you're trying to do the diagnosis. Why are they there? What's happening? And when you're first trying to find out about somebody, of course, what are you going to do? You're going to ask them questions. Questions about their family, about their upbringing, and all of these details and this information gives you a better insight into why they do what they do. So looking into Solomon's life, what was his beginnings? You know, what was his family dynamics? And we see so much stuff there, we don't have time to go over all of it in detail. But his dad is King David, of course, and we know that there's a lot of dysfunction in this family. I mean, you think there's dysfunction in your family? No, nothing like this, believe me. There's a show, I haven't seen it, but it's called Modern Family. I've heard that it just talks about a lot of dysfunction, if some of you have seen that show before. But this is far worse than that. I think this is probably taking that up and bumping it up many levels, because there's a lot of just infidelity going on here. Solomon's older brothers are just trying to run his dad out of the kingdom. I mean, you have Absalom just staging a coup. What is that all about? And then here at the beginning, we see in 1 Kings, and I hope you brought your Bibles because we're definitely going to be in the scripture a lot this weekend. The origins of this man, Solomon, that we're going to study about, starts here in 1 Kings when his kingdom begins to get established. Now, in 1 Kings chapter 1, again, I have to go through this pretty brief of what's happening. You know that David is dying, he's nearing the end of his life, and Solomon is just about to take over. But first, it can't start that easy. There's got to be some drama. There's got to be some drama. The Bible, like I told you, it just says what it says. It's honest, and I appreciate it. It is the Word of God. And so we have in 1 Kings chapter 1, verse 5, Adonijah. Now this is a brother of Solomon, okay, an older brother, okay, a son of David. He exalted himself, saying, "I will be king," and he prepared for himself chariots and horsemen and 50 men to run before him. So although I'm sure he knew that years ago Solomon was the one chosen next in line, he didn't care. Dad's sick. Solomon's the little scrub, the younger one, you know, and I think that I'm good enough to be king. And so he takes the priest, Abiathar. He takes the commander, the warrior that was alongside of David so many years, Joab. He takes him as well. And they all go and start to try to make him the next king, which of course turns into a lot of trouble because this is not the way that God had planned things originally. So of course, fast forwarding some, Prophet Nathan finds out about this, Bathsheba finds out about this, they talk to David and say, look what's going on. They're trying to make Adonijah the next king. They're trying to make him the next king. Don't you think that you should be doing something about this? And later on, you see that David is very clear on his instructions and in telling them, you have to anoint Solomon and do it now. Okay, so just think, this is chaos that's happening right now. This person wants to be king, and then so the people are following him, and then later they hear all this noise, and now they're following Solomon. And finally, they realize that as Solomon gets anointed king, he realizes that all the people were affirming that decision, and then Adonijah became scared, and he realized that his time was up, that the coup was over, okay? And so what happens in this new kingdom of David having such a strong start David having such a good strong reign, being called the man after God's own heart, now Daddy's chapter is about to close, and now Solomon, the young, inexperienced Solomon, is about to start. So what happens in the beginning of his kingdom? If you haven't gotten a chance to read over this story, it can be actually pretty bloody. It's really not a rated G story, like I mentioned before, that the Bible is very honest and clear. What actually happens and takes place in the beginning of Solomon's reign is a series of very decisive, very swift action against these people that were staging the coup in his kingdom. Joab gets killed. David gives the instruction to his son, saying, well, Joab, because of what he's done, because of him, some acts that he had committed earlier during David's kingdom, and it's a shame that that happens. If you've gotten the chance to read the whole story from 1 Samuel on to, you know, through the Chronicles, Joab was so faithful to David. Man, that guy could fight. I mean, I would read that, I'm like, this guy was so faithful to David all the time. But what a shame that how he gets remembered at the end. He has to be executed because of poor decisions that he's done. And so Solomon had to be swift. He knew that at this beginning, what God wanted to do with his people left no room for sin to creep in. And so he went out and executed this judgment. He had Joab killed. Abiathar the priest had to be exiled. And Shimei, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Some of you scholars can correct me. He was another person during David's time that had cursed David before, but David forgave him, but he gave the instruction to Solomon saying, hey, watch out for that guy. And eventually, he had to be killed as well. So at the end of verse 46, we go into chapter 2, verse 46. Okay, if you want to follow along there. Chapter 2, verse 46, so the king commanded Benaiah, so this is the new Joab, okay, the guy that took Joab's place. He went out and struck him down. Who's him talking about? Shimei, the last guy that I told you about. And he died. And thus the kingdom was established in the hand of Solomon. Bloody start. But swift, decisive, and obedient. It reminds me of even Saul. Remember when Saul was commanded to kill the Amalekites? And what did he do? Did he kill it? No, he saved some, you know. He thought, oh, but God wants me to sacrifice. And I say, how can we get rid of all these beautiful animals here and everything? And what did Samuel tell Saul? Do you guys remember? Does the Lord delight so much in what? In the sacrifices as he does with obedience. To obey is better. I think that Solomon, this isn't in the text, so I'm being honest with you, but I feel that there's a parallel that Solomon is in the beginning is so swift to execute the judgments because he says, whatever God tells me to do, even if it seems, you know, whatever it is, I will obey. To obey is better than sacrifice. Amen. Thus the kingdom was established, it says here. And now we go to the transition. This is where we're going to set ourselves for the next few minutes in this message, the first message here in Solomon's life for Sabbath school. chapter 3, which is a very famous story that we hear about the beginning of the kingdom of Solomon, where Solomon requests for wisdom. So after all of this background that you hear, that you've heard about how his kingdom started to take place, we have now here some information regarding after the establishment of Solomon's kingdom. So let's start reading here from chapter 3, verse 1. It says, "Now Solomon made a treaty with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and married Pharaoh's daughter. Then he brought her to the city of David until he had finished building his own house, and the house of the Lord and the wall around Jerusalem. Meanwhile, the people sacrificed at the high places because there was no house built for the name of the Lord until those days. And Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David, except that he sacrificed and burnt incense in where?" Okay, just making sure you're with me. I know that was a winded introduction. Good. "Now the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. Now at Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream at night. And God asked, and God said, 'Ask, what shall I give you? Ask, what shall I give you?'" Well, in verse 1, 2, and 3 here, we have some random bits of information. Maybe you'd heard this story before, didn't realize in the beginning, wait a second. I mean, does something seem a little off to you as you start reading that passage? This is, chapter 3 is where Solomon is rising in his power here because of what happens. But at the beginning paragraph here, we have some things that seem contrary. You know, our little radar start to pick up on the signal of him making a treaty with Pharaoh, marrying the daughter, and also going to the high places. What comes to your mind when you read high places? Is this a positive thing or a negative thing? Yeah, high places. I mean, there's probably other verses, many verses, I'm sure, throughout the Old Testament, maybe even New Testament, where high places is something that we don't want to go to. But when we read some of the commentaries and when we see some of the background here, we have to notice a few things. Well, first of all, why a marriage to Pharaoh's daughter? Why did the... It's an unknown writer in 1 Kings. We're not sure who wrote it, but whoever the original author was, why would he include that bit of information in the beginning of this chapter 3, his life of Solomon? Well, marriage with the daughter of Pharaoh probably was a move to secure the borders at this time. Egypt, the empire of Egypt, was very weak, actually, very weak. And Solomon controlled all the land between Egypt and the Hittite kingdom. So perhaps it was a move from the Egyptian king, Pharaoh, to help secure his borders. And Solomon, of course, maybe wanting the extra help, went ahead and said, maybe this is for the best. The next verse is high places. We can say maybe this is something negative, but the author includes that word in Hebrew, rock, you know, meaning... the thing is, you have to notice, where else could they worship, right? If we go back to verse 2, chapter 3, it says, "Meanwhile, the people sacrificed at high places because," see, it gives an answer, "because there was no house built for the name of the Lord until those days." So we can't jump into conclusions too much because the house of the Lord hasn't been built yet. So where are the people going to worship when there's no house, you know? And so the high places, although... yeah, originally for pagan worship and things like that, he's trying to say that Solomon didn't necessarily do a bad move in this regard, because later in verse 3, it says, Solomon loved the Lord. Solomon loved the Lord, walking in his statutes, like his father David did. And so in verse 7, no, excuse me, still in those verses, we know through context that Solomon journeyed 7 miles to go to Gibeon. Gibeon was one of the best high places. A reference in Chronicles, it says that this Gibeon was a mosaic tabernacle. It had a significant place, and it was a special place. And Solomon traveled a long ways to be able to sacrifice 1,000 burnt offerings. Seems like overkill. 1,000. Just imagine all them dead cows or how, you know, whatever the animal was that they sacrificed. But Solomon was very serious. You can see in many different instances that at the beginning of his kingdom, Solomon wanted to do this thing right. Saul, according to his family background, and as a counselor, you can make so many assumptions of how somebody's going to be like because of their family, right? Monkey see, monkey do. It's the sad fact that some people get dealt a deck of cards that's very different from other people that are raised in a healthy, loving, nurturing home. And what happens developmentally to kids when they don't come from that structure? Well, Solomon was a young guy, and he saw his share of dysfunction in his house with his one of his brothers wanting to rape the sister and a few of his brothers wanting to take over. I mean, just imagine this family. And yet here we've already seen traces that Solomon is choosing to be different. He is choosing to start his kingdom off now that God has placed him in this place a different way. So he goes into this Gibeon. He brings the thousand offering, and God, at night, in his sleep, probably undisturbed by an alarm, God speaks to him in his sleep, there when he had made such an attempt to have God approve of his kingdom. And so here's the dynamic part. We keep reading on. Chapter 3, verse 6. Follow along with me here. So the Lord says, "Ask, what shall I give you?" And Solomon says, "You have shown great mercy to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in truth and in righteousness and uprightness. You have continued this great kindness for him. You have given him a son to sit on his throne, as it is this day. Now, O Lord, my God, you have made your servant king instead of my father David. But I am what? What does it say there in the text? I am a little child. I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people too numerous to be numbered or counted. Therefore, give to your servant an understanding heart to judge your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of yours?" Wow. Let's pause for a second there. Let's pause. What does this say? He's asleep. This stuff is coming out of his unconscious. God talks to him. What? Ask, what shall I do for you? And first Solomon, as we noticed there, doesn't even talk about himself, but he goes back to his father, David. He says, "You have shown great mercy to your servant David, my father. He walked in truth and righteousness. And now you've given him a son to sit on his throne." He doesn't even mention his own name. What is Solomon doing here? What kind of response is this? I think the way that the text is reading, Solomon realizes that he had nothing to do with him being king. God appointed him king. You know what's amazing? Existence. That your consciousness, you being conscious of your own existence, you could have been, I don't know if you've had this thought, I have wacky thoughts like this sometimes. I could have been born in any other country. I could have been born a female. I could have been born living somewhere. The reason why, follow me here, I mean, this is kind of crazy, maybe for the morning, I know, but I acknowledge that I exist. Everything that you and I know about the world is through the experience that we see, you know, and how amazing that, like, who's to say that you know, that's you? Did you pick to be you? Did you have anything to do with your parents and you being born and you realizing that you're alive? Are you kind of getting what I'm saying? It's kind of weird thoughts, you know. It's so profound to me, just something as simple as existence. You had nothing to do with who you are, those things that you like, the bananas like me and the pastor like, and and you had nothing to do with if you're an extrovert or introvert or where your parents were born. You had nothing to do with that. God had everything to do with that. And Solomon here acknowledges, "Oh Lord, my God, you have chosen me to be here. You have appointed somebody. You have appointed David's son to be here in the throne." And then the next part, "I am but a little child." Would you like your leaders to be saying that they're like children? It seems a strange thing because we hate to be called childish. At least I do. You know, I struggle with that a little bit because I am young and now I'm in a profession where I'm counseling some people, and some of them look at me in the first session so weird, like, boy, my problems are older than you are. I've had people tell me that. What do? I argue? I smile and I tell them, you're right. Help me understand. I'm just here to hear you out, you know. Because it's true. Sometimes we don't like someone to say that we're childish in that way. So why is this that it seems like it's such a strength in the beginning? You know, Ellen White has a quote in Prophets and Kings. Ellen White speaks regarding of Solomon. She says, Solomon was never so rich or so wise or so truly great as when he confessed, I am but a little child. I know not how to go out or come in. Mm-hmm. Solomon was never so rich or so wise or so truly great as when he, here in this text, confessed, I am but a little child. I know not how to go out or come in. Are you a little child? Amen. Or through the years, as other things began to happen, it's so ironic that even yesterday, before my wife really knew what I was going to speak about, we were talking about adulthood. And since we just are in that transition, I'm recently married, 7 months, and we're now, you know, I'm almost there. I'm graduating in December, but my wife has now been working for a year and a half as a nurse, graduated, and now comes the bills, you know, stuff you guys have been doing for years, you know, now we're experiencing for the first time. You know, we're not living at home. We're getting the bills. We're discovering what adulthood is all about. And my wife said something to me that was really interesting. She said, you know, I've really caught myself forgetting what it's like to be a kid. I've caught myself forgetting what it's like to be a kid when you knew that mom and dad had it all under control and you trusted mom and dad and you enjoyed life to the fullest. Every time you didn't worry about where things were coming from, you just enjoyed, you had this faith, you know. It's so wonderful to see kids enjoy things for the first time. Last weekend, I went camping with my nephew for the first time. He was experiencing camping. He's 3.5 years old. And it was a joy to see him get into that tent, seeing the fire and baking the s'mores. I mean, I've been camping many times before, but it helped me enjoy it more, seeing him enjoy it for the first time. What is the text saying here? Why is Solomon so strong when he here mentioned and acknowledged to God that he is a little child? That he is a little child. Well, what is this saying? Well, we can't be foolish like children. 1 Corinthians 14:20, it says, don't be foolish in the wind of doctrine, believing this and that. So, okay, so we're not talking about that. We're not talking about being fickle, like in Ephesians 4:14 is talking about children being fickle. No, the Bible is not trying to support that. Matthew 11:16 talks about Jesus saying it's not all about games and playing games and being childish in that way. But what is the verse talking about? My friends, I think that it's talking about that as children we must desire the sincere milk of the word. Let's read 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2. Let's turn there, please. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2. So Solomon was so strong when he realized and he attributed himself as a little child. So what does this say in 1 Peter 2, 2? As newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. As children, we must desire the sincere milk of the word. Desiring the pure milk of the word. Kids know what they want, don't they? Yep. Who has kids here? Who has children? They're probably, some of them are grown, some of them are really young. We don't have kids yet, you know. We're holding out on that for a few years, amen, you know. But we want to eventually. But I've worked with kids a lot for many years, and they know what they want. And when they want it, you know, it's hard to deter them from that. You know, sometimes as adults, it seems that our desires get weak. Our desires even for the Word of God, our desires for things to be changed in our lives are weak. Maybe we train ourselves to be self-sufficient. We work hard and we think that our life is all about that sufficiency, and we forget the beautifulness of depending on God and really wanting something and desiring it and coming to Daddy God and saying, Lord, you have to take control in this circumstance. So Solomon realizes that. Solomon realizes that he must depend fully on God, and his desire must be to judge his people. And here I'm wrapping it up here in the last section in verse 9. As we go back to 1 Kings chapter 3 in verse 9. So the first thing Solomon says is, I'm but a child. I don't know how to go out or come in. Therefore, this is the request that Solomon gives to God. Give to your servant an understanding heart. Why? To judge your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of yours? Who is able to judge this great people of yours? What does discernment mean? What is Solomon really asking for in this text, in verse 9? Discernment, wisdom to judge the people. It's about making choices, isn't it? Imagine if you were king. You know, all the choices you'd have to make, I would never want to be that, or the leader, or the president. Right now, we don't have to go into that with our congresses and everything, but I would not want to have all of those decisions at my disposal, because sometimes I have a hard time even making a choice. I don't know if they have that where you guys are from, Minchies. Have you guys heard of Minchies or Sweet Frog? Like frozen yogurt? It's not like an actual place. It's a frozen yogurt rest. I guess you guys maybe don't have. You do. Okay. Well, we have the two popular ones are Minchies and Sweet Frog. No, they don't sell frogs. Again, this is frozen yogurt, okay? And so in the store, you walk in, you have the different flavors. They let you, you pay just out of how much your cup weighs. But you get your cup and you just put in the frozen yogurt. My wife loves it. I mean, it's like a sweet, it's exactly like Sweet Cece's, exactly. Yeah, we have one of those too. Mm-hmm. So going in there, it seems so simple, frozen yogurt. But I tell you, my friends, even there, sometimes I can get stressed because I don't know what to get. Do I mix the strawberry with the chocolate? No. Do I want to add the peanut butter with the chocolate? And then, to make matters worse, then they got all this row of toppings. Well, what do you put? Do you layer it just right? When do you put the sprinkles? Are you feeling like in the mood for the hot fudge today? My wife knows. She's systematic. She goes in there. She has the science. She knows exactly how to make the best use of the space of the cup with the price and what she likes. And I just end up just mixing it all together, just cookie dough and just whatever, you know. It all ends up in the same place, I say, you know. But you know, that seems like such a simple choice. We're talking about ice cream, frozen yogurt, and things like that. Imagine being a ruler. All the decisions you have to make every day, it would drive me mad. People, your subjects coming to you, different situations happening, you have to take all the environmental factors into account. You have to make a judgment that's going to affect them for the rest of their life. Solomon probably here realized this is overwhelming. Oh God, these are your people. I'm a little child. How am I going to do? Lord, just give me your discernment. Because my friends, you and I, there's too much bad stuff in us. We can't be trusted to make our own discernments all the time without the Word of God to be our guide. We just cannot. Without that relationship with God, we cannot. And Solomon, even though he's king, where he had a chance to be arrogant here, he's had enough years of observing the dysfunction in his family's life for him to say, I want to come out of that. I'm not a product. I'm not deterministic of a product of that dysfunction, but I'm going to be like my dad, and I'm going to start strong, and I'm going to obey the word of God. Oh, Lord, give me a spirit of discernment. Give me a spirit of discernment. Now, the phrase discerning here in the Hebrew, it literally means a listening heart. In Hebrew, the word for listening is the same as obeying, which is very interesting. Because I guess it makes sense. You're not really listening unless you're obeying. You're not really listening until you're obeying. Because it's funny, as an adult, you're telling your kid, Johnny, go please clean the dishes. Okay, Mom. And you tell them again. How do you really know that they've heard you, isn't it, if they acknowledge it and they go and they do it? So it's interesting that in the Hebrew, those two are the same. Solomon must obey the Lord by keeping God's commandments in order for his heart to be prepared to lead others. You see, Solomon cannot lead others. How is he supposed to discern if he doesn't know how to obey himself? How can Solomon even attempt to rule or know what is right or what's wrong unless he has that ultimate source of what is right and what's wrong, with a leader guiding him? How is he to lead others? So two things. What is the beginning of the strength of Solomon? Notice in the text, Solomon says he is but a little child. He's but a little child. It seems humiliating. It seems embarrassing. We don't like to be treated like children. But here it's clear because Jesus even said, remember in Matthew, unless you become as? You will not what? You will not enter the kingdom of heaven. The disciples thought they were hot stuff. They're arguing about who's the greatest. And he brings a little child that doesn't know exactly what's going on, that is just living that moment by moment, just trusting in mom and dad to take care of his needs. Unless you become as little children, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. And so we must be careful in how we are. Are we self-sufficient, or do we have the attitude of a little girl or a little boy? And God is our daddy, and we're depending on him fully for everything. So those are the two things. That is what God has to teach us this morning in regards to the beginning of Solomon's rule. It says later, Solomon was so blessed. People were coming from all over to hear his wisdom. God later was so pleased with his answer that the scripture tells us that he told him that nobody would come close to him in wisdom. He would be far greater. His kingdom flourished. Solomon made new forms of government. He developed the temple. Everything prospered under his hands. And this is the beginning that we have to attribute it to. To God be the glory that he was able to use Solomon because of his attitude of humility and his desire for discerning for his people. It wasn't for him. It was for blessing of other people. See, it goes right along with if you guys were here last night, with what the pastor was talking about and being a vessel for those rivers to come through you so God can use you. God can't use us when we're not like the children in our heart, when we're not humble in that regard, and if we don't acknowledge that everything that we are is because of God. We're any intelligence we may have, anywhere that we're placed, whatever our gift, who we are. What control did you have with who you are? Who's your name? You think about yourself, your whole life. You had no control over that. God has chosen you and me for his glory and his honor, just like he has now chosen Solomon to be a vessel. And this is how his kingdom started so beautifully and flourished. So this is the end of the first talk. And later on, we're going to go into the next two subjects, the two areas of Solomon's life. And so in wrapping it up, we have one more verse to read. Just remember, James chapter 1, 5-6, it says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. It's not exclusively to Solomon. How beautiful that God grants all of us that gift of wisdom if we are to desire it and ask like Solomon did.